Hello friends, so in the previous couple of lectures we've been considering the thermodynamics of solution under a specific condition. So this specific condition, it involves a solution, meaning a solution in this context means a liquid that comprises of a single component, say A, that is rather placed in a vacuum. So when this liquid is poured into this vacuum and it is not completely filled but rather partially filled, what happens is some portion of this liquid gets converted into vapor and the component A occupies the unfilled section of this system. So the vacuum is not energetically a stable state. So in order to replace the vacuum, some portion of the liquid A get converted into vapor and occupies the region that is not being filled by the liquid. Now, once a certain degree of vapor pressure is achieved, there is an equilibrium established between the liquid and the vapor that is above that liquid that surrounds it. Now, this specific degree of vapor pressure, we refer to it as the saturated vapor pressure. Saturated vapor pressure. And this depends on the component or the material, the liquid that we are considering. So therefore, it is represented, rather it's vapor pressure, so it is represented as P naught E. Now, we saw that this equilibrium is not a static one, but rather it's a dynamic one, meaning like the components in the vapor state, they are allowed to interact with each other. They are also allowed to interact with the liquid, and some of these components, some of these atoms, they get consumed by the liquid, and in order to match up the loss of the saturated vapor pressure, the loss in the saturated vapor pressure because of the adsorption of some of the atoms into the liquid loses some atoms elsewhere, and this is this rather balancing action of in some region, that is because of the interaction between the atoms and the liquid, an absorption takes place, and in some region there is a balancing of operation. This establishes a dynamic equilibrium. Now, this is the case for a liquid of unary material A. Now, if you consider, we have considered or we began considering the solution that involves two unary components A and B. Now, we saw that while considering the case for the case of a single component liquid, the rate of condensation and the rate of evaporation are equal in the dynamic equilibrium. To establish a dynamic equilibrium, the rate of evaporation and the rate of condensation should be equivalent. Now, because of the equivalency, it is possible for us to rather express the rate of condensation or the rate of evaporation based on which of these two is rather easy to formulate, since both these are equal under dynamic equilibrium. Based on which of these two, either evaporation or condensation, which is rather straightforward to formulate, we can formulate that and equate it to the other. For instance, if the rate of evaporation is easy to formulate, then we can formulate it and equate it to the rate of condensation because both are equal under dynamic equilibrium. Now, if under this condition we saw that the rate of condensation depends on the number of components that are present in the vapor phase. So if you have an increased number of components, then correspondingly the rate of condensation increases, because like we saw, the condensation involves the interaction between the vapor phase and the liquid. So when you have an increased number of atoms in the vapor phase, the number of interaction, the amount of interaction between the vapor phase and the liquid increases, and therefore the rate of condensation increases. So it becomes rather straightforward for us to formulate it. Therefore, what we essentially then can do is we can equate the rate of condensation to that of evaporation, assuming that the system is in a dynamic equilibrium. Now, in the previous, so now when we consider the solution of A and B and compare it with the liquid A, what we essentially have is the difference between these two is that in case of A and in case of the solution AB, the amount of A atoms that is present is relatively less when compared to A. So that is the key point that we need to remember for this discussion. When compared to the complete solution or the complete liquid of A to that of the solution of AB, certain portions of the A is removed in order to replace or in order to accommodate B. So therefore, the amount of A in the solution AB is less than the A in the complete liquid A. So you have a complete liquid A and compare it with a solution AB. In AB, the amount of A is less. Now, when you have the less amount of A in AB or relatively less amount of A, then it corresponds to the relatively less amount of A in the vapor phase. So when you have a relatively less amount of A in the vapor phase, then the correspondingly the interaction between the A atom and liquid is compromised. So what essentially we end up having is the rate of condensation of A is correspondingly reduced in the solution AB when compared to A. So therefore, even though initially for the liquid A, the condensation of liquid A, the rate of condensation of the liquid A is expressed as a proportionality constant, which depends on A, which is rather, it is a material constant, it is rather governed by the nature of the material A and the saturated vapor pressure. So this is what governed the condensation rate of A under this condition here, wherein we just have a unary liquid present. So this is the expression that dictated it. Now, when we have a solution, this rate of condensation is correspondingly, or it is rather compromised by the decreased amount of A that is present. So therefore, we express it or we normalize this rate of condensation in a solution by including the concentration of A, which varies when compared to this solution here or this liquid A here to that of the solution. The only variable is, particularly with respect to A, is the change in its concentration. So therefore, we express it as XA, we include it in this expression, and or we normalize the rate of condensation of A with respect to its concentration, and you have a proportionality constant, the same proportionality constant, because it is dependent on the material, not on its concentration, it is the material parameter, and the corresponding vapor pressure of A. So you have a difference. So this vapor pressure depends on the nature of the solution. When you have a complete A liquid, the vapor pressure is different when compared to a solution that comprises of A and B. And correspondingly, the other difference in this expression here is we have included the concentration of A because it is a solution that comprises of both A and B, and depending on or the key differences in solution, it is not completely A alone, there is only a portion of the A. So that means there is only a portion of atoms that are available in the vapor phase that can interact with the liquid, and this ultimately governs the condensation rate. So you have expression for two condensation rates. So you can write this expression for the condensation rate in this manner. So we have expression for two condensation rate. One is in the solution, the other is in the complete liquid state. So we have a liquid A and a solution of A and B, and we have arrived at two expression for the rate of condensation. Now, irrespective of the nature of the solutions, be it AB or completely A, irrespective of it, we saw that in that such condition, a dynamic equilibrium is established, meaning the rate of condensation should be equivalent to that of the rate of evaporation. So there should be an equivalency in the rate of condensation and the rate of evaporation. So only then a dynamic equilibrium will be established. So therefore, it is possible for us to rather equate these two expressions here. So in both these cases, we have assumed that there is a dynamic equilibrium that has been established. So irrespective of the vapor pressure of A in the solution AB or in liquid A, the system with solution AB or in the system with liquid A, irrespective of it, the rate of condensation should be equivalent to that of the rate of evaporation. So there is an equilibrium therefore that has been established. So these expressions, they correspond to the dynamic equilibrium condition. So therefore it is possible for us to relate or equate one rate of condensation to that of the other, and when we do that, what ultimately we end up having is this expression here, that is we are relating this expression to that of the expression, and since there are equivalent parameters, that is these are material dependent parameters, this constant of proportionality, the proportionality constant, it cancels out each other, and ultimately we end up with this expression here, which is nothing but A is the product of this. So what PA is nothing but the vapor pressure of A for a given solution AB, and this vapor pressure of A for a given solution AB is the product of its mole fraction or the concentration of A, which is expressed in mole fraction, to that of the saturated vapor pressure when only A is present. So when you have a solution AB in a vacuum, and essentially because of the vacuum, the remaining vacuum that is present, there is some evaporation that occurs, and there is a vapor pressure of A that is present. This vapor pressure is equivalent to the product of the concentration of A in the solution and the saturated vapor pressure, which would be established when we have just A alone in the vacuum. So that is what this expression means here. So it is the product of the concentration and the vapor pressure when you have just A alone in a vacuum. The same expression can be extracted for the B as well, which again would be the product of its concentration, which is expressed in mole fraction, and the saturated vapor pressure of B when only B is present in the vacuum, which is established when only B is present in the vacuum. Now when we try to plot, when we attempt to plot this change in the vapor pressure, how this vapor pressure changes when with respect to that of the concentration, it is possible for us to consider the concentration in the x-axis. So let us assume the concentration or in the x-axis, and it is xB. So this is the concentration of the component B or the material B along the x-axis. And now when the system completely comprises of the B alone, so that is what 1 means here. So 0, there is no B present, and 1 means it is completely, the system completely comprises of B. So the system is something like this, it completely comprises of the material B. Now in that case, when the system completely comprises of material B, its mole fraction is 1, and the corresponding vapor pressure is the saturated vapor pressure P not P. Now when you don't have, at the other extreme, when you don't have any B present, when the concentration of B is equal to 0, then in that case the vapor pressure of B will be 0. So it is here. Now as the concentration increases, there is a linear relation that shows correspondingly the vapor pressure of B increases. So as the concentration of B increases, linearly the corresponding vapor pressure of B increases. So you have one point and you have another point, and this relation states, or this expression states, there is a linear relation. So therefore we can graphically represent how the vapor pressure changes when the concentration changes. So what we have done is, now again instead of treating it numerically, we have represented this expression in a graphical manner while capturing all the essential aspects of it. So what are the essential aspects? I mean, when your system comprises completely of B, the mole fraction of B is equal to 1. So that means the partial pressure of B is equal to the saturated partial pressure of B. So that we have established here. So this condition has been established here. The other condition is when you don't have any B present in the solution, then the mole fraction of B is equal to 0. So the corresponding partial pressure of B will be 0. So that we have captured it here. See other condition, we have captured it here in this point here. Now the relation between these two is linear. So there is a linear line that connects these two points. So what essentially now we have established is we have now graphically represented how the partial pressure of B changes when you increase the concentration of B. So if you have a solution, you have the concentration of B in that solution is varying, and correspondingly how the vapor pressure of B varies is what we have graphically illustrated. Now let us do the same for A. Now when we do the same for A, we will be able to do it in the same plot. We don't need to consider another plot, because one advantage of using the mole fraction is xA plus xB. The summation of the different mole fraction is equal to 1. So what it means here is, at this point here, the xA is equal to 0, and at this point here, the xA equal to 1. So at this point, the xA equal to 1, and at this point, the xA equal to 0. So if xB increases in this direction, what we have is, we have an increase in xA along this direction, meaning you have 0 of xA here and 1 of xA here. Now, similarly how we treated the B, it is also possible for us to treat A, meaning when at this point, when the xA is 0, when the xA is 0, there is no vapor pressure that is present. So we have one point here. And then the same way, when at this point here, when all that the solution comprises of is A alone, then the xA is equal to 1. So essentially what we end up having is, we end up having, so let me, instead of having the partial pressure or the saturated partial pressure of A and B equal, let us assume that when the solution entirely comprises of A, its partial pressure is here. So we have identified two points for A, as we have identified for B, how the partial pressure changes when there is no A present, when the solution completely comprises of A. Now the relation between these two is linear, and therefore we will be able to arrive at such a curve or such a relation that indicates how the partial pressure of A changes when the concentration of A varies. So the blue line represents the partial pressure of A, and the black line represents the partial pressure of B. So now it is possible for us, now that we have an expression, we are able to relate these two, we are able to relate in a system what is the partial pressure of A and what is the partial pressure of B. Let us go to another page. So far what we end up having is, we are now in a position to graphically represent, without losing any critical aspect, without losing the trend in how the concentration influences the vapor pressure, without losing a trend, we are able to arrive at a graphical representation that indicates how the vapor pressure of a component varies when its concentration changes. So this is something that we have been able to achieve. So this is xB. Now when you consider xA, what we end up having is, this is 0 and 1. It increases this direction, and this increases in this direction. And the trend is similar to the trend, how the vapor pressure of B changes is similar to how the trend exhibited by the change in the vapor pressure of A. So correspondingly, it looks something like this rather. So we have represented the change in the vapor pressure of B and the change in the vapor pressure of A. So this representation ultimately, or it indicates that we now know the value of the vapor pressure of A and vapor pressure of B in a given solution. So what this representation means is, if we have a solution that comprises of, say, this concentration x a bar and x b bar. So this concentration here, if we consider a solution of this concentration here, from this representation we will be able to calculate the what is the corresponding vapor pressure of B and what is the corresponding vapor pressure of A. So this representation means that we are able to rather estimate the corresponding vapor pressure of A and B in the solution. If this is the solution, this is the concentration of A and B, then correspondingly we will be able to estimate the vapor pressure of A and the vapor pressure of B. Now when we consider the overall vapor pressure, that is PA and PB, so this is what is formed in the system. So in the system, when you have the combination of A and B, when you have the combination of A and B, it is not only A that evaporates, it is also B that evaporates. So therefore the vapor pressure is not exclusively governed by A or B alone. The vapor pressure in such a system wherein you have the solution of A and B, the vapor pressure in such a system is governed by both A and B. So you have the presence of both A atoms and also you have the presence of both B atoms. So they both constitute the vapor pressure in the system that comprises of solution A and B. So we have this expression now, and we are now able to quantify, measure how each of these vapor pressure is dependent on its concentration, and we have a numerical expression that relates how each of this vapor pressure, the vapor pressure of A in a solution, is dependent on its concentration. So this is the expression here. Now when we substitute this expression here, what we end up having is the overall vapor pressure when a dynamic equilibrium is established in a solution that comprises of A and B is expressed as xA P A naught and xB P B naught. So this is the expression that indicates how the overall vapor pressure changes when you have a combination of, or we have when you have a solution of A and B present, how depending on the concentration the overall vapor pressure changes when you have a solution of A and B in the system. Now this expression, it is possible for us to represent it in this figure here, meaning this expression can be represented in this figure here. So we need again 2 points. One point is when all that is present is A. So all that is present is A, meaning xA is equal to 1, and since xA plus xB, that is the mole fraction of A, and B should be equal to 1. So in this case, this means xB is equal to 0. So this is the point here, and at this point the overall pressure is equivalent to that of the saturated vapor pressure of A. So that is this point here. And in the same way, when you have xB equal to 1, that means xA is equal to 0, and at that point the overall pressure is equal to that of the saturated vapor pressure. Now again you can replace this one of these terms, that is xA, or let's say xB can be replaced as 1 minus xA. So because we have expressed it in mole fraction, the xB can be replaced in this way, and when we do that, this expression here turns into a linear expression, meaning the overall vapor pressure adapts a form something like this. So this is the overall vapor pressure that includes both the vapor pressure from A and vapor pressure from B. So what essentially we have arrived at is, now we have graphically represented how the vapor pressure of the solution that comprises of A and B changes with the change in the concentration, and that we have graphically represented. So what this indicates is how the vapor pressure, or how the amount or the number of the A and B atoms, again the vapor pressure meaning the amount of atoms that are, or the vapor pressure or the pressure that is introduced by the vapor when you have a solution AB in a vacuum. So this is the setup that we have considered, and this is the vapor pressure that has been established, and this vapor pressure is dependent on the concentration of the solution. And depending on the how the concentration varies, the correspondingly the vapor pressure that is established here varies, and it is the combination of both A and B. Now, when we just plot, again, considering that the vapor pressure, it reflects the number of atoms that is present in the vapor state or vapor state rather. So what we have established, what we have ideally shown is that when you present the overall vapor pressure with respect to that of the concentration B, so you end up having the change in the vapor pressure with respect to the change in the concentration of the solute is expressed in this manner. So this is how. So what we are in the black, using the black line, we are representing the overall vapor pressure, which is the combination of A and B, and it assumes this form here. So this point here is the saturated vapor pressure of A, and this point here is the saturated vapor pressure of B, and here what we have is how the vapor pressure changes when there is a combination of A and B, and in that combination we are representing the concentration in the form of mole fraction. So this is how the vapor pressure changes when you have a solution with varying. So you consider a different solution with a different concentration of B, and this is how it varies. Now, so far what we have considered, so the way we have arrived at this particular representation, the way we have arrived at this understanding is, so far we have assumed that even though A and B are mixed, they behave as how A and B would have behaved in their individual case. So that is what we have so far assumed. Let me repeat, what we have, in order to arrive at this graphical representation, even in order to arrive at this expression that we have considered, or rather in order to arrive at this expression here, what we have assumed is, we have assumed that the solution, even though it comprises of both A and B, this solution behaves, the A in the solution and the B in the solution, it behaves in a way like how it would have behaved had it been present in the individual cases. And that is how we were able to arrive at this expression. So let me repeat, the way we were arrived at this expression, the way we were able to relate the PA to that of P naught A, is just by including the concentration, meaning we assumed that the behavior of A in the solution is just influenced by its concentration alone. So when you compare it with the complete solution of A, the difference that we observe is only dependent on is the number of particles that are present. It's only the difference that it makes is just the concentration. So it behaves, this A, it behaves in the same way that it behaves in a solution, the A in the solution AB, it behaves in the same way how it behaves in an ideal case, in a complete solution of A. So the behavior, there is not much change in the behavior. So how it would behave in the ideal case or in the complete solution, so this is a complete solution, or in an homogeneous case, in an elemental state, how it would behave, it is the same behavior that is being that we observe in the solution, except for there is a decrease in concentration. So that is what we have assumed so far. So what we mean is, we have a solution of AB, and we have assumed that the way A behaves in the solution is the same way how it would behave in its elemental state, and the only difference here is it has a decreased concentration, and that assumption has given us this representation of the partial pressure. Now, it is also possible that the A in the solution assumes a different behavior, meaning the A, instead of being separate, or instead of establishing, or instead of being related to A alone, or means B, instead of being related to B alone, it is possible for A to establish a relation with B. So when I say that A behaves as A in the solution as well, means the A is not inter, or it is not interacted with sufficiently with B. So when I say the A behaves in the same manner in this elemental state as in the solution, it means when we look closely, there is only a bond that has been established. So the bond that is established between the A is with another A atom. So there is not a complete mixing that has been established. So what has been established is we have a combination of A and we have a combination of elemental A and elemental B. There has not been an intermingling of two components AB. So far what we have considered is a solution where you have this combination present and this combination present. We have not considered a solution where this combination occurs. So what we mean by that is we have not considered a condition where there is a complete dissolution of A and B. We have considered a condition where just AA is present, and so that we have considered a condition where just elemental A is present and elemental B is present. They are present in a single state, so they are present in a single system, but they have not completely dissolved. A bond between A and B has not been established. So that is, this assumption is what offers us this particular depiction. This understanding comes from this assumption here, which is the behavior of A in the solution is similar to of it in the elemental form, meaning there is no change in its behavior, there is no change in the way the A is present in the solution. It is still surrounding itself with other A atoms. It has not completely dissolved with the B atom. The same goes for B. The B in the solution, it behaves similarly to its elemental form, meaning it has surrounded itself with B, it has not mingled with the A atoms. Meaning both these, even though are present in the single system, they have not completely dissolved. And that is what yields us this representation here. When they are not completely dissolved, only then the primary difference will be the difference in the concentration. When they are completely dissolved, when such a bond is established, then we need to consider other factors as well. So what the underlying assumption for this understanding is that the A stays A in the solution and the B stays B in the solution. There is not a complete dissolution. There is no formation of such a bond. So in that case, the only difference is the concentration, and therefore you see a linear relation between the behavior of A in the elemental state and in the solution. So the linear relation is because the A remains A in the solution and the B remains B in the solution. And that's the reason why we have seen, we observe that such a simplistic, a linear dependency on how the vapor pressure of A changes with the concentration. This relation is because there is an underlying assumption which we have assumed that, or which we have considered that, which we have adopted that. That means the A stays A in the solution and the B stays B in the solution, and there is no complete dissolution between A and B. When there is a complete dissolution between A and B, you establish a bond like this. Now, when you establish a bond AB, what essentially happens is you have established a complete dissolution between the component A, between the material A and material B. And when you focus in the atomistic scale, what you would have is you would have AA bonds that are present, BB bonds that are present, and AB bonds that are present. Now we are relaxing this assumption and we have considering a case wherein there is a complete dissolution. So we have three bonds that are present. Earlier that was, there was just two bonds. A state, so the elemental form of A state separate, the elemental form of B state separate, there was no intermingling. Now we are considering a solution wherein there is a mingling between A and B. Now in such a case, what we have is we have a bond energy that corresponds to AA, a bond energy that corresponds to BB, and a bond energy that corresponds to AB. Now we have implicitly considered these two under this case here, when we assumed that in the solution the A behaves in its elemental form, the B behaves in its elemental form. We have implicitly treated or assumed these bond energies in this illustration here. So what we have not assumed is this bond energy here. So instead of getting into the or treating it again numerically, let us consider a case wherein this bond energy of AB is less than the bond energy of AA and BB. So you have a bond energy of AA and AB, BB, which we have considered, and this has given us this linear relation here. Now, in addition to that, we have AB, which is less than that of bond energy of AA, BB. So this means that in addition to the atoms that are released because of the condition we are in, the atoms that are released to the vapor state by overcoming this bond energy, we will have atoms that reach the vapor state by overcoming this bond energy as well. So in order to achieve this vapor pressure, the vapor pressure that is indicated by the black line here, these bond energies need to be overcome. So you have bond that is established between AA and BB. Only when you break away from this bond, the A will get into the vapor state. Now, when this condition, that is the condition to break away from AA and BB, is established, then automatically, since the condition to for the atoms from to break away from AB bond is less than AA and BB, automatically this condition is also satisfied. So therefore, the atoms from AB bond will also be released into the vapor. So let me repeat, for the atoms to be gathered into the vapor phase, you need to overcome a specific energy, and that energy is nothing but the bond energy that holds the atoms in the liquid phase. So when you consider the liquid comprises of elemental A and elemental B, you have two bond energies, that is bond energy between AA and BB. Now we have considered that in addition to AA and BB, we also have a bond that is formed between A and B. Now this bond energy is less than AA and BB. So in order to achieve the vapor pressure that is indicated by the black line, you have to overcome this. Since in the black line, this bond energy has already been overcome, so this means the bond energy that corresponds to AB bond has also been overcome. So that means the atoms A and B, in addition to being removed from AA bond and BB bond, the atoms are now going to be removed from AB bonds as well. So essentially then what we would observe is, we would observe an increase from this linear relation here. So from this linear relation, which assumes that there are only AA and BB, and both these energies are overcome, so there are only bonds between AA and BB, and both these energies are overcome, that gives you the straight black line. Since the energy between AB is less than that, the atoms are automatically released to the vapor phase from the AB bonds as well. So therefore, there is an increase in the vapor pressure. So vapor pressure depends on number of atoms present in the vapor phase. Now usually these atoms are released from only AA and BB. Now we have a third bond AB, and in the third bond, this third bond energy is easily overcome because already AA and BB bonds are overcome. So therefore, since this bond energy is also is able to be, or we have overcome this bond energy, so atoms are now not only released from AA and BB, they are also released from AB bonds. So therefore, there is an increased amount of atoms that are present in the vapor state, and that means there is an increased amount of vapor pressure, and that is what is represented by this red line here. Now if you consider the other case wherein the bond energy of AB is greater than the bond energy of AA and BB, in that case the number of atoms that are present in the vapor phase are reduced, because even though this black line exactly overcomes these two bond energies, it is unable to overcome the bond energy that rather holds AB together. So in that case, we have the vapor pressure that adopts this form here. So what we have is, we have a solution. We have considered two forms of solution. One, in one form of solution, the A, it behaves as, or it behaves as its elemental form, and the B behaves as its elemental form. It means there is no mingling between A and B. Even though they are present in the single system, they continue to behave in their elemental form. So what we mean by elemental form, a simple way of representing it is, in this solution, the A is bonded with A and the B is bonded with B. Now when we have such a case, the vapor pressure is only dependent on, because the behavior is similar to that of its elemental form, the overall vapor pressure of such a solution is only dependent on the concentration. There is no other variable playing a role, and that is the reason why you have this linear representation of the black line. On the other hand, if we observe a complete dissolution wherein the A and B are mixed and we have the bond forming between A and B, we no longer have the linear relation, because we have a complete solution, dissolution of A and B, and the relation now is dependent on the energy that needs to be overcome in order to bring, or in order to establish, a vapor phase. And this energy, it should not only include the energy between A, the energy between the similar atoms, but also the energy between the dissimilar atoms. And this energy between the dissimilar atom is given as EAB. Now, depending on how relatively the energy between the dissimilar atoms varies with respect to the energy between the similar atoms, we have a difference in how the partial pressure changes in a completely dissolved A and B solution. And when the energy between the dissimilar atoms are less than the energy between the similar atoms, it means for a given energy which has already overcome the similar atoms, you will be able to produce more number of atoms, you will be able to allow more number of atoms into the vapor phase, because the energy that holds the dissimilar atoms are smaller. The same way in this case here, when the energy between the dissimilar atoms are higher, you are only able to overcome the energy between the similar atoms, then the atoms that are trapped in the dissimilar bonds will not be transformed into the vapor phase, and therefore the overall vapor pressure will be less than that of this linear relation. So the solution wherein the atoms behave similar to that of their elemental form is referred to as the Raoultian solution. So it is, I hope the spelling is right, so it's a Raoultian solution. And the solution wherein you have a complete mixing of A and B. So when the A and B, when they begin to, or when they behave as in their elemental form in a given solution, you establish a Raoultian solution. The reason we refer to it as the Raoultian solution is because this linear relation here between, or the way this linear relation between the saturated vapor pressure of A and B and how the overall vapor pressure of the solution is linearly related to the saturated vapor pressure of A and B, this linear relation here is expressed as the Raoult's law. So this is referred to as the Raoult's law, where there is a linear relation between the overall vapor pressure to that of the saturated vapor pressure of individual components, and they are related by their corresponding concentration. And this expression is referred to as the Raoult's law, and therefore the solution wherein the components behave as if they are in their elemental state, they are referred to as the Raoultian solution. The other solution wherein there is a complete dissolution between A and B, and therefore you have bonds forming between A and B, and there is a difference, and there is a disparity, or there is a different trend, a non-linear trend that has been adopted, such solution we refer to as the Endrian solution, because this non-linear, a non-linear behavior is exhibited by a solution when there is a non-linear relation between the saturated vapor pressures of the component and the overall vapor pressure of the solution, then such a relation is called as Henry's law. So we have Raoult's law and Henry's law. The Raoult's law establishes a linear relation between the vapor pressure of the individual components that is dependent on its concentration. In case of Henry's law, there is a non-linear relation because the Henry's law considers a complete dissolution, whereas Raoult's law treats a solution wherein the components behave in there as if they are in their elemental form. So therefore, we have these two different law and correspondingly two different solution, Raoultian solution or Henry's solution. The simplest way of representing the solution is the Raoultian solution, wherein you have a linear relation wherein there is no complete dissolution of A and B. So A and B, they behave as if they are elemental form. These are often referred to as the mechanical mixtures. And wherein you have the complete dissolution occurs. So that is what we generally refer to as the solutions. So the Raoultian solutions or the Raoultian mixtures, they are nothing but mechanical mixtures. There is no complete dissolutions that has been formed between the two elements that are present. So these two elements behave as if they are separately formed, even though they are present in a solution. They have not completely assimilated themselves, they are not completely dissolved. They behave as if they are in their elemental form, even though they are found in a solution. So these are nothing but mechanical mixtures. And the linear relation that we see here, it is for the mechanical mixtures. And on the other hand, when we have a complete dissolution, we observe a non-linear relation depending on the factor that governs the dissolution. Here the factor that governs the dissolution is the bond energy. And depending on the factor that governs the dissolution, we have a difference in the relation between, or difference in how the partial pressure of the solution changes. So the key takeaway of the structure, the key takeaway of considering the thermodynamics of solution, is that we need to understand the difference between the mechanical mixture and the solution. So when we consider these pressures here, the black line here represents the pressure that establishes the dynamic equilibrium. So depending on the nature of the solution, the factor that establishes the equilibrium varies. In case of the mechanical mixture, it is the straight line. In case of the complete solution, it is either red line or blue line, depending on the nature of the components we have. So therefore, when we are considering the solid solutions as well, we need to consider what is the nature of the solution in order to appropriately describe the factors that dictates its equilibrium. So that is what we will be considering in the closing lectures of this course. We will be considering, or we will be attempting to relate this understanding of the thermodynamics of solution to the solid solution, wherein we will be attempting to consider a true solution, a solution such as this, instead of a mechanical mixture. So depending on the nature of the solution, the correspondingly the factors that establish the equilibrium varies. So with this, I would like to wind the structure up. We will build on this. We will adapt this understanding to solid solution in the upcoming lecture. Goodbye.